Good morning, science friends. Today we are talking about polar molecules. Now, we've been talking about polar covalent bonds and non-polar covalent bonds. And so that's gonna lead us right into polar molecules. And then next we'll talk about a specific polar molecule, which is water. And it's very important polar molecule. And as you take biology next year, you'll learn more about that and why. So what is a polar molecule? Well, a polar molecule is one end, has one end that's slightly negative, so we would say it's electronegative, and one end that is slightly positive, so we would say that's electropositive. This is the Greek symbol delta. And so that's the lowercase delta. Sometimes you'll use this delta. That delta you may have used in math before, and it shows change. But this is the lowercase delta, and it's used for electronegativity. So water is a great example of a polar molecule. You see this water here. Oxygen is more electronegative. Hydrogen is more electropositive. You can tell that by looking at their the electronegativity numbers on that special periodic table that I gave you. And so because it's a polar molecule, and it has these polar covalent bonds, these electrons are not shared equally. Remember, that's what we mean by polar. The electrons are not shared equally. The electrons are being more pulled towards oxygen because oxygen is more electronegative than hydrogen, and so it gives that oxygen molecule that partial negative charge, okay? And it gives that hydrogen molecule, or atom rather, a partial positive charge. So you see those electrons aren't shared equally. And so these arrows that you'll sometimes see are used to show if the electrons are being shared equally. And you always put the point in the direction where the electrons are pulled towards, okay? So molecules like these that have two charged regions or two charged ends are referred to as a dipolar molecule. So let's look at another example, HCl. If we were gonna draw HCl, it would look like this. Chlorine is more electronegative than hydrogen. So chlorine is gonna pull those electrons, all right? Hydrogen's gonna end up with the partial positive charge. Chlorine's gonna end up with a partial negative charge. And so when you have that, that's referred to as a dipole or a dipolar molecule, okay? If it has charged ends that are different, it's referred to as a dipole. So when you look at polar molecules in an electric field, if the electric field was turned off, you see these molecules are oriented in different directions. Sometimes the red's pointing this way, sometimes it's pointing up, sometimes it's pointing down. It just looks different. But once you turn on that electric field, you'll notice that these orient themselves. The positives are always orienting to the negative plate, and the negatives are always orienting to the positive plate. That causes polar molecules to line up. If you had non-polar molecules in there, this might be an example of our hydrogen chloride like we just had, but if you had a non-polar molecule in there, there's no charged region, and so they don't line up. Even once you turn the electric field on, they continue to look like picture A over here, okay? So, just because a molecule has polar covalent bonds does not mean that the entire molecule is polar, okay? So I'm gonna write this up here. I want you to write this up too. Polar covalent bonds does not equal a polar molecule. And we'll talk about why in just a second if I can write, okay? So let's look at these two examples. Carbon dioxide and hydrogen both have, my screen's jumping all over me, both have polar covalent bonds, okay? If we draw water, it looks like this. If we draw carbon dioxide, and y'all know how to draw these Lewis structures. We've done them well. Okay. Now, usually when you've drawn them, you probably haven't drawn it bent, but if you looked up the shape of water after you drew it and determined the steric number, you would see that it's a bent molecule. So I just went ahead and drew it bent. If you looked at carbon dioxide after you determined the steric number, you would see that it's a linear molecule, okay? So that's why it's drawn straight across, all right? So both of these have a polar covalent bond. Hydrogen's gonna be the partial positive charge, oxygen's gonna be the partial negative charge. So the electrons are being pulled in this direction. I don't know why, but when they use these, they always put this cross on the end. That's just tradition, I guess. But that's what you do, all right? So the electrons are drawing to the oxygen end. Here, they are also drawing to the oxygen end, okay? Both oxygen ends. And so let's go look up in this and read. The effect of polar bonds on the polarity of an entire molecule depends on the shape of the molecule and the orientation of the polar bond, okay? So this one, the electrons are both being pulled up towards oxygen in the water. All of the electrons are gonna be pulled up towards oxygen. Now over here, the electrons are being pulled out in equal and opposite directions. I sound like I'm quoting Newton's laws here. But they're mirroring each other. And so because of that, these cancel out, okay? If you have polar covalent bonds in opposite directions between the same two elements in a linear molecule, those polar covalent bonds, those differences are gonna cancel out, okay? This is like a game of tug of war between two friends that are equally weighted, okay? Nobody can pull each other over the line. It's, it's the same, okay? And so for this reason, CO2 is considered to be nonpolar. Water, however, is considered to be polar because you have that partial positive and partial negative charge. You end up not having a partial positive and a partial negative charge. So if we put carbon dioxides in that electric field, nothing's gonna happen. They're gonna orient however they want to. They won't line up because you don't get that partial positive and partial negative. Carbon dioxide's not a polar molecule, even though it has polar covalent bonds, okay? So I want you to pause for a minute. If you didn't already write some notes on that, or if you did, I want you to stop right now and answer this question right there in your notes. Explain why CO2 and H2O are polar and nonpolar respectively, and draw a diagram if it helps. So pause and do that, and then we'll reconvene. Okay, so we talked about this just a little bit in class last week. Intramolecular versus intermolecular forces. So everything that we have talked about thus far is an intramolecular forces. They are gonna be our stronger forces, stronger than intermolecular forces. So they hold a molecule together. If you're holding F2 together, it is done by an intramolecular force. That's a covalent bond. It's an intramolecular force. Going back to our water, that is a covalent bond. It's an intramolecular force. If you have something like magnesium oxide, that's an ionic bond. It's an intramolecular force. It holds one molecule together. This is one molecule, okay? And those are the strongest ones. Now, intermolecular forces are gonna be a little bit weaker, but they're important because they give us our state of matter. They help to determine state of matter. And specifically, this one does, okay? So here, the dispersion forces are very weak. These are gonna be stronger, and these are the strongest. So if we go down this list, we are increasing in strength. Okay, these two together, I want you to bracket these in your notes. I didn't have a way to really draw that well. But these two together are referred to as van der Waals forces. So I kind of previewed them to you a little bit last week. I know I did on the Monday, Wednesday group. I can't remember if I did on Tuesday or Thursday. But you've got van der Waals forces and hydrogen bonds, okay? So the dispersion forces, let's talk about those first. We see the dispersion forces at work a lot in our halogens, okay? Or in our Hoffbrinkels. So remember we have F, one of our Hoffbrinkels is F2. The next one, if you're looking at those halogens in group 7 on your periodic table, is Br2. And then the next one would be iodine. And so it's I2 because those are the Hoffbrinkels. So that means they're diatomic molecules. They always have to be, they're always going to pair together with another one so they can share those 7 valence electrons and make that bond in the middle. Okay. Now, would these be polar or nonpolar? Well, they're nonpolar because their difference in electronegativity is 0, right? Fluorine is 4. But the other fluorine is 4 too. So 4 minus 4 is 0. So these are going to be nonpolar molecules are going to show dispersion forces. Okay? So fluorine, if you look at fluorine, fluorine is a gas at standard temperature and pressure. Okay? Bromine is a liquid at standard temperature and pressure. And iodine is a solid at standard temperature and pressure. What makes them different at the same temperature and pressure? Well, it's a result of their dispersion forces, okay? I want you to write this too. The increase the number of electrons, then you're gonna increase the dispersion force, okay? Of these three listed here, fluorine has the fewest electrons, and so the dispersion forces between two fluorines is less, okay? That's why it's a gas, because it doesn't have a lot of force to hold those molecules together, and so they just spread out. Bromine has a few more electrons, okay? So it has greater dispersion forces than fluorine, and so it's got a little bit more strength. Bromine is a liquid at room temperature for that reason, or standard temperature pressure for that reason, okay? And then the last one, iodine, has even more dispersion forces, because it has even more electrons. And so they're gonna pull each other even closer together, snuggle up even more. And that makes iodine a solid at standard temperature and pressure, okay? So they're very weak, but they're important because they help us determine state of matter. These result from momentary dipoles. And so what that means is that typically they are not a polar molecule, but as they come closer to one another, then the electrons will kind of shift, so to speak. And so they experience what's referred to as a momentary dipole. Uneven distribution, right here, uneven distribution of electrons between neighboring molecules as they approach one another, okay? Because remember, molecules are always in motion. Atoms have kinetic energy. They never stop moving until they get to that absolute zero temperature, which is negative 273 degrees Celsius, which is what that Kelvin scale is based off of. Remember, you use Kelvin in the standard temperature and pressure calculations, okay? So that's the dispersion forces. Let's look at the next one, a dipole interaction. A dipole interaction is gonna be a stronger interaction in a polar molecule, okay? In a polar molecule. So let's say, for example, hydrogen chloride. That's a polar molecule. The difference in electronegativity in chlorine and hydrogen makes that a polar covalent bond. And so chlorine has the partial negative charge. Hydrogen has the partial positive charge. So it has a permanent net dipole, okay? And so it's a stronger attraction. Chlorine's gonna pull those electrons harder, and so when you have many hydrogen chlorides, right? So there's one, here's another, you know, here's another. They're going to attract to one another. Those chlorines and those hydrogens from opposite molecules are going to attract to one another because of dipole interactions, all right? Notice, this is my intramolecular bond. I drew it with a solid line. This is my intermolecular force. You always draw those in with like a dashed or dotted line. Okay, I'll show you again in this picture. This is showing water. So here is an intermolecular force that pulls two waters together. This is that intramolecular covalent bond, okay? So that's the next strongest force, that dipole-dipole interaction. Now, the last one is a hydrogen bond. So the hydrogen bond is a much stronger attraction, but still not as strong as the intramolecular forces, the covalent or polar or ionic or metallic, okay? From a permanent net dipole, so again, it's also a permanent dipole, with hydrogen being bonded to nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine, okay? So, the NOFs. Okay, hydrogen bonded to a nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine makes it a hydrogen bond, okay? So we see hydrogen bonds in water would be an example. We would see hydrogen bonds in hydroxide. That was one of your polyatomic ions. We would see it in HF, which is hydrofluoric acid. We would see hydrogen bonds in NH3, that's ammonia. So lots of elements do, or lots of compounds do have hydrogen bonds, but they are the last intermolecular force and the strongest of the three, okay? So you have an assignment today on inter and intramolecular forces, and just being able to identify those and kind of draw them in. I guess that's it for today. So some of you may be wondering about your dropper. That's for the Monday group, the Monday group will do that with me in class. The Tuesday group will do that at home. So Monday, Wednesday kids, if you still have your dropper, then just bring it back to class. Tuesday, Thursday kids, you all hang on to that and you'll use that at home on Monday, okay? If you have any questions, let me know. And if not, then you'll have a great day.